had much time to review the grammatical errors, and I just concentrated more on structuring the course to you so that it would help you to do your projects in GD&T, or at least you can have a career in GD&T. So we'll move to the topic for today's discussion. So the synopsis of today's meeting is, today's discussion is GD&T, for which the synopsis is like I have planned more time for the prerequisite or basics of GD&T. So once you are strong in the fundamentals, I think you can easily learn the symbols used in GD&T. We'll spend some time on the applications. What happens if GD&T is not used? So what are the failures that you might encounter? So those things we'll discuss in more details. And then finally, I've given some time for a questionnaire session. If you have any questions, you can also ping me. So I'll just make sure that I can see the chat box. Okay, you can pick me. So we'll just stop in between so that we can have your solutions to the questions, and then we'll move forward. So the first slide would be on the GD&T preamble. So in GD&T preamble, we'll be discussing on what do you mean by GD&T, and who actually invented GD&T, or where does GD&T come from, followed by why we need to use GD&T or the necessity of GD&T. So what was that before GD&T was introduced? We had traditional dimensioning into use, and how different GD&T is from traditional dimensioning. And finally, what is the benefit of GD&T? This is just a small introduction about GD&T and its preamble. If you have any issues in my audio or in the slides that I'm sharing now, so do let me know. So the first thing is that what do you mean by, what is GD&T, or geometric dimensioning and tolerancing? So it is clear that GD&T is a universally accepted standard for dimensioning and tolerancing of 3D design parts. So in GD&T, you use some symbols and notations, which are actually, we have a standard system, already predefined symbols and notations. The main reason why we use these symbols and notation is that to make sure the part is set to function. So the use of these symbols and notations is based on the function of your part, or the relative function of the part. That is, the part might have a relative motion to another part. Based on that, we will be specifying the symbols and notations. So either directly on, based on the function of the same part itself, or based on the function of its relative part. Thirdly is that we in GD&T, we have a third point is that we have a well-defined feature. So which means that you have number of geometric features in 3D designs. So these geometric features in 3D designs can be defined accurately without reducing its tolerance, without tightening its tolerance. We can actually define the geometric feature, and you can get the same physical part from the manufacturing side itself. So you can see this small image below. I have just shown you a shaft, and along with the shaft, I've also shown you a small hole. So both the shaft A is a perfect shaft. So it is perfect flat in nature. And you can just see the shaft B, which is said to be bent. So what happens is that both the shafts, as per the inspection team, both the shaft will pass the quality inspection, because the only scrutinizing factor we have given is the diameter. So if the diameter is between 20 plus or minus 0.01, both the shafts are acceptable. But with respect to the function, so what is the function of shaft B? The shaft B has to enter into the hole. So if the shaft is bent in the virtual condition means if I'm just looking at from the side view, you can just see that the diameter of the shaft from the top point of the bent and the point at the endpoint of this vertex will be more than 20.5, more than the diameter of the hole, and the bent shaft will not enter into the hole. But still, based on the dimensioning that you have provided, it is actually a good part. It is acceptable as per inspection. But still, you have failed to control the geometric feature. So by using GDNT, you're actually controlling this feature, and you make sure that you manufacture the part within the tolerance. Along with that, we also make sure that the shaft enters the hole. That is, it performs its function. Now, who invented GDNT and where does the GDNT come from? So GDNT is not something, a recent invention, like we have invented in 2000 or something. So GDNT was actually invented by Stanley Parker of Royal Torpedo Factory, Alexandria in Scotland. So he has invented, he doesn't invented the entire GDNT. Actually, he developed the concept for true position. So once after the concept for true position has developed, the further concepts, depending upon the requirements, came into effect. We had profile, flatness, perpendicularity, coaxiality, cylindricity, and so on. So we have 14 tolerances in GDNT. So one, the first tolerance in GDNT, like first, one of the first tolerance in GDNT was developed by Stanley Parker in 1938. Then GDNT was actually in use in US as a US military standard in 1950s, and later it came to industries. So we have a standard organization governing it. We have ASME, American Society for Mechanical Engineers. They have the standard 382 pages GDNT book, that handbook that we need to follow, which will have all the symbols and notations and rules and regulations that you need to follow when specifying the GDNT to the part. So the current standard that we follow is ASME Y14.5/2018. Its predecessor is 2009. So the difference between 2009 and 2018 is that we have removed certain tolerances. We have removed tolerances like concentricity and symmetricity was removed. It's like we need not use concentricity and symmetricity. It can be replaced by other existing tolerances itself. Like concentricity can still be given by using another tolerance like runouts. You can still specify it using other tolerances. So that's the reason it got removed. So you have like the ASME started like from 1982, we had the first ASME standard was given in 1982. Then we had it 1994. So this GDNT is said to be evolved from many versions, and then you have many inputs will be added at each and every time. It's just a derivative. It is not a single standard. It keeps on evolving depending upon the requirements. Now the next topic is why we need to use, why GDNT is necessary, or why we need to use GDNT. So I have just shown you the first figure on the top left corner. You can just see, before GDNT was used, we had traditional dimensioning and tolerancing. In traditional dimensioning and tolerancing, in some cases, we don't specify tolerances itself. So I know that tolerances is nothing but the upper and minimum limit, or the maximum allowable deviations and minimum allowable deviations. You can give it to a particular dimensions is what we call it to be as the tolerances. Still, it is acceptable. So here in the first image in the top left corner, you can see that there is no tolerance. There is no 40 plus or minus 0.1 or plus or minus 0.5 or something. There is no tolerances. So the traditional dimensioning, generally we don't specify any tolerances. And sometimes we have tolerances given as general tolerances. For all the dimensions, we give one tolerance. Similarly, the second image beneath it, you can just see a stepped shaft. This is also a typical example for traditional dimensioning. Here we have given tolerances, but still you can see that the axis of the shaft, we haven't given any GDNT, or there is no control in the axis of the shaft, which means that the step one and step two need not be coaxial in nature. The axis of the step one need not be coaxial with the axis of the step two. Or these two axes can be offset by a system, by a distance. Still, the part is acceptable, because the only only point we use to check in dimensional inspection is its diameter. As long as its diameter lies between 20 plus or minus 0.1, it is acceptable. Even if the axis, the one that I'm showing in red, so the axis of the step two is not in coaxial with step one. Even if it is offset, it is still acceptable. But the question is whether it would perform as per the intended function or not. While assembling it might be an issue. That's because of the offset in the axis, it may not assemble into its respective female part. So then it might be an issue. So these issues we had it in traditional dimensioning. And the one on the top right corner, you can just see a small image I've just shown. So in GDNT, for example, if I am the designer and I want a part as per the one which I'm showing in the mouse pointer, so I want a part which is having a base plate and a particular pin-like structure which is perpendicular to it, and the dimension of the pin is 8 mm plus or minus 1. But the manufacturer is giving me a part which is in the next image. Still, the part is acceptable because I haven't given any information to control the geometry of feature or geometry feature over here. I've just said that the part should have a pin and the pin diameter should lie between plus or minus 1, 8 mm plus or minus 1 tolerance. Still, this part pin diameter is lying between 8 plus or minus 1. If you cut section the part at anywhere and you check its diameter, it will show you 8 plus or minus 1. But whether this will go inside a straight hole, no, obviously it won't go inside a straight hole. Then what I have to do is that I have to control this geometric feature using GDNT. I need to specify that when, with respect to a datum flat surface, the axis of this pin should be perpendicular and it should lie between 0.3 mm. So if I draw a small cylinder over here, whose cylinder's diameter is 0.3 mm, and this axis of the cylinder should be perpendicular to the datum A, this surface, and this axis should lie between another small cylindrical tolerance zone of diameter 0.3 mm. So we'll study this in detail, but just I'm saying that if you're not going to use GDNT, obviously you will end up with a part which is still acceptable as per your dimensions, but it won't perform its function. A similar example is shown below. If you have a table-like structure over here, and if I'm giving a height of the table as 40 plus or minus 1, at one side I might have a table of height at maximum dimension, at the other side I will have a table of height with minimum dimensions, so you will have a slanting table. So this is not acceptable. Similarly, so then what I have to do is to introduce a GDNT. I need to say that the top face of the table whose imperfections or waviness should lie between two parallel planes whose tolerance is 0.03 mm. So by this way, I will make sure that the shape of the surface is controlled and it is not slanting in nature. Otherwise, if you're not going to specify the GDNT, what happens is that one point you have to remember is that by default, whatever size tolerance that you give over here will be taken as the controlling factor for the shape of the surface. If unless and until I give a GDNT, so that by default, the size tolerance controls the shape of the part. If you give your GDNT, then the shape of the top surface will lie between these two parallel planes. Otherwise, the size tolerance, that is a 40 plus or minus 1, will actually control the top face, will control the shape of the top face. Whether it should be slanting, whether it should be parallel, will be by default controlled by the size tolerance if there is no GDNT provided. So the takeaway from this page is that in earlier traditional dimensioning, we didn't have tolerances. We were unable to control the geometric feature properly or accurately. And without GDNTs, your manufacturing people will give you a product which will pass the quality inspection, but still it won't perform its function. So GDNTs are necessary to make sure that the shape of the geometry is accurate and it performs its function for which it is designed for. So finally, the benefits of GDNT, as said, this is something before the GDNT was introduced, what happened is that each design engineer will have his own standards, or each organization will have their own standards, symbols, and techniques. So when they share their prints to manufacturing team, what happens is that there will be misinterpretation because I will have a particular way of technique or particular way of organizing the print, providing the symbols, and my interpretation will be differing from the interpretation of another design engineer. So obviously what happens is that the manufacturing side will actually sow, we are just sowing the seed for misinterpretation, and this will in turn increase the scrap rate, because the part won't meet the specifications and the manufacturing engineer will give a part which is completely different shape and size, and this will lead to what is called higher scrap rate. But now we have a uniform and universal standard that everyone can recognize and follow throughout the world. Second thing is that when you use GDNT, we actually accurately control the geometric feature. We could accurately control the geometric feature without decreasing the tolerance. Without tightening the tolerance, we can get the same geometric feature. In some cases, we also provide bonus tolerance. We give more tolerances. So we'll discuss what is more tolerances in the upcoming slides. In addition to that, one point you have to remember is that when you have more tolerances, when you give more tolerances, you're actually increasing the bandwidth of accepting the samples. So more samples which lies outside the tolerances are now inside the tolerances and are acceptable. So more samples will be accepted, less will be the internal scrap rate, so less cost will be there. And also we have datums. So we'll have datums. GDNT has actually given the beautiful concept of datums. See, datums are something which is also not only helps us to define the GDNTs. Not only this datum helps us in defining the GDNTs, but also it actually instructs the manufacturer on how to arrest the degrees of freedom of the part and how to hold the part in the jigs and fixtures so that you can machine the required geometric features or surfaces of the part. Similarly, it also instructs the inspection team or the quality team in the CMM lab, coordinate measuring machine lab, on how to measure the dimensions, from which datum you have to measure, how to hold the part in the CMM machine, and how to measure the dimensions from which datum or from which point you have to measure the dimensions. Such information can be provided by using the datums. So this advantage was actually added after introducing the GDNT, and it is interchangeable. A part produced in US or part produced in India, we can be interchangeable in nature. And finally, you can completely define and control all the features of the part without compromising the tolerance. So these are the benefits of GDNT. And next is the prerequisite or some basic terminologies and concepts that you need to learn. So we'll spend more time on the prerequisite. This is much more important because the symbols and notations that you use in GDNT learn in any time. But if you unless and until you're not having enough understanding on the basic, it will be difficult for you to understand the symbols and notations. And symbols and notations you can learn easily, just self-understandable also. So first is nothing but the feature and feature of size. So there is two, the feature and feature of size are actually different. So feature is nothing but a particular portion of the part. It can be a surface, it can be a hole, number of holes. So it is a physical portion of the part, whereas feature of size is the dimension associated with that physical portion of the part. For example, you can see at the image below. So the spokes of the wheel is a physical portion of the part, which is a feature. Similarly, the holes is a feature, whereas the diameter of the hole is a feature of size. So a slot can be a feature. The width of the slot is a feature of size. Pin can be a feature, diameter of the pin can be a feature of size. So all dimensions associated with the physical portion of your part is feature of size. So I hope that you have understood feature and feature of size. The next important basic thing you have learned is the maximum material condition and least material condition. So what do you mean by maximum material condition is that feature of size, that is the dimensions, that has maximum, for example, maximum material condition, what is the dimension at which your feature of size has maximum material in it? Okay, and similarly, what is the maximum condition at which, minimum condition at which the feature of size has minimum material in it? For example, if you take a hole, which is an internal feature, we call hole as an internal feature, the maximum material condition for the hole is its diameter. Similarly, if you take a pin, which is an external feature, it is projecting out. So the maximum material condition for a pin is the largest size of the pin or its outer diameter. So the maximum size for a hole is its inner diameter or the minimum diameter. For example, the figure below, you have a hole which is 10 mm. So the maximum material condition for the hole is 9.9 mm. Because a simple way to remember is that if you want a bigger hole, I need to machine it, you remove the material. Okay, if you want a smaller hole, I have to remove only little amount of material and more material will be in the stock. So for holes, it is minimum diameter. and for shaft it is maximum diameter. The same thing in vice versa, we'll have it in the least material condition. So least material condition is the feature of site that has minimum or least amount of material, but still it should be within the tolerance zone. It should not go outside the tolerance zone. It cannot be 10.2 or 10.3. So if it is a hole or an internal feature, so I think I made a mistake here. So it should be LMC, least material condition should be. So for a hole or a internal feature, the least material condition is its maximum diameter. And for a pin or an external feature, the least material condition is its minimum diameter. Now, I think if you can just open your chat box. So I just want you to say me what is the maximum material condition for this diameter. I hope that it is not a hole. So it is a external diameter or hollow diameter outside the outer diameter or outer hollow diameter, can consider it. So what is the maximum diameter for this dimension? MMC condition, or just specify me the MMC condition. You can just type in your chat box. Okay, I don't know how 2.28 has come. I think you have added it in the wrong significant digit. So the answer is 2.01. So yeah, okay. So yeah, everyone has given the right answer. So the thing why I have taken this answer is that the question is that this is on the outer diameter of the hollow cylinder. So you have to remember that its maximum condition is similar to the external feature. Similarly, you can just see for this hole, you can just provide me the LMC, least material condition for this hole. Or the maximum material condition for the hole. Anyone, okay, you can just provide me the least material condition. So since it is an internal feature, so the least material condition for this hole should be its maximum diameter. So it should be 0.179, should be LMC. And the maximum material condition for the hole to have more material will be its minimum diameter, which should be 0.7171. Okay, so the max material condition is 0.171, and the LMC, least material condition, is 0.179. So the reason for which I have given this example is that you could see some small modifiers here. So this modifier we'll be discussing, and this is what we call it as a feature control frame. So here you can just see a small diameter symbol, which actually says where this center point of this hole should lie, within which tolerance zone it should lie. So that information will be provided. So this is peculiarly, this particular feature control frame is peculiar for these holes. We'll see that in detail. So the next important concept that we'll see is the rules in GDNT. So we have certain rules in GDNT. So we need not go much deep into it. It gives you more confusion. So we'll have some basic understanding. You just remember these two points. If I'm going to have a part or a feature can be this particular pin. If I have a feature which is in the maximum material condition, then the feature should be Perfect. That means it should not have any waviness, no bend. That's what the GDNT says. For any feature which is at the maximum material condition, then the feature should be a perfect envelope. So it's also called to be as the envelope principle, because it's a perfect envelope. Perfect cylinder is an envelope. We call it as envelope. So it's also called to be as the envelope principle or the Taylor principle. So you can see this below image. I have a hollow cylinder as well as I have a shaft. The shaft diameter is 5 plus or minus 0.01. So the shaft is an external feature. So the maximum material condition for the shaft is 0.501. And the minimum material condition for the shaft is 0.499. So here it is clear that the second image over here. So if the shaft, so the first image you can just see, if the shaft is at the maximum material condition, that is 0.501, then the shaft is bent. Okay, so it is clear that when you consider the bending, when you consider the in the virtual condition, that is from, you know, take a look from the top side view of this particular shaft, it is clear that the total diameter of the shaft, considering the bending into account, will be more than the minimum material condition of the hole, that is the maximum hole size you can have. And it is not possible for the shaft to get inside the hole if it is having the maximum material condition and it is having a bent. So I hope I didn't confuse you. So you can just see that the hole for the, see, the maximum hole size that I can have is 0.50. So the maximum hole size that I can have is diameter is 0.508. So, but if I'm more 0.508, now if I'm having a shaft which is already in the maximum metal condition, that is the diameter is really thick, really large maximum. And in addition to that, if I'm also having a bending the shaft, then indirectly I'm adding more diameter to the shaft and it will be difficult for it to get into it. So generally here I want a loose fit. So my aim is to fit the part with clearance. I don't want an interference fit. I want to fit the part with clearance. So generally if you just do a stack up, so maximum clearance I want, it should be like, when will I have a maximum clearance? I will have a maximum clearance when the shaft diameter is small and the hole is said to be of larger diameter. So the larger diameter of the hole is 0.508 and the maximum diameter of the shaft is 0.501. So I'll have a clearance. Maximum clearance I can have is 0.007. Clear. And the minimum clearance that I can have, still I can have minimum clearance I can have is when the hole size is really big. So the hole size is really big. For example, if it's 0.501, for the shaft is having a highest diameter, maximum diameter of 0.501, and the hole is having minimum diameter, that is 0.502. So the difference is like 0.001. So this is the minimum clearance I can have. So if I'm going to have a shaft which is already in the maximum material condition and it is again bent, obviously it what happens is that it will have an interference fit. So to avoid that, the rule number one says that if you already have a shaft which is at the maximum material conditions, then the shaft should be a perfect straight cylinder. It should be round. It should not have any bent. If it has a bend, then obviously it cannot fit inside the hole. And if you are, in other words, so, but at the same time, if you have the shaft at a least material condition, so this 0.499, then you have some allowances. And if you have the hole, you have the maximum diameter of the hole as 0.508. So you have some allowances and still you can fit the shaft inside the hole with some clearances. So, but if a particular feature is at maximum material condition, it should be a perfect straight and round part to avoid or to make sure that it performs its function. So the rule number one, you have to remember one thing is that If your feature is at maximum material condition, then it should be perfect. In rule number two, you have to remember that if there is no information is said to be provided in the feature control frame. So you can see a small system of boxes for this whole 10 mm diameter whose size tolerance is 0.1. That is, the diameter of the hole can vary from 9.9 mm to 10.1 mm. So here, if there is no information is said to be provided in the feature control frame, whether it is maximum material condition or the LMS least material condition modified is not specified, by default you have to take the regardless of feature of size. We will learn what is regardless of feature of size and modifiers in the upcoming slides. One thing that you have to remember is that if there is no information is said to be provided in the feature control frame, by default you have to take regardless of feature of size. So this is rule number one and rule number two. So the final takeaway is that if a feature is in maximum material condition, it should be a perfect straight and round. And if there is no information is provided in the feature control frame, you have to go with regardless of feature of size. These are the two basic rules you have to remember in GD&T. Next is the datum feature. So datum and datum feature are two different concepts, so they are not the same. So what we will do is, the datum is something which is theoretical. So you can just see the at the bottom right corner, you can just see a small image having a particular block kept on different planes. There is one plane, the bottom plane, which is said to be gray in color, right? So datum A is this gray plane, I'm just considering it as a datum because it is an ideal perfect surface and it is an ideal perfect surface. It is smooth, it does not have any waviness. Then what is a datum feature? Datum feature is, it is associated with the part. It is actually a portion of the part. Okay, it is associated with the part. So what is the datum feature? The bottom surface of the part, which is now hidden. So the bottom surface of the part, which is in contact with this datum, with the gray plane, is actually called as the datum feature. So the thing is that the datum feature, which is a portion of the part, cannot be an ideal surface. That is, it cannot be 100% smooth. It cannot be having without any waviness, because it is a physical part. It is produced by the manufacturing process. So obviously it will have some waviness. So it cannot be an ideal smooth surface. Then why we need datum and datum feature is that this is necessary when you are doing an inspection purpose to have the dimensions of the part from an ideal surface. At that time, we might say the coordinate measuring machine, that you go to the bottom surface of the part, take some 4 or 5 points on the bottom surface of the part, and then you create an ideal plane. Okay, from that plane you measure the other dimensions of the part. So this for measurement purpose, for the purpose and as well as for holding the block purpose, we generally use datums, and you always need to associate a datum with the datum feature. So how you will represent this datum? So we'll represent the datum by the following notation, which you can see. So datum feature notation A. So this is what the feature of the part, which is in contact with the ideal datum surface A. So this is how you have to represent the datum. We'll have a shaded triangle followed by the datum symbol. A box, inside the box you have to specify the datum. So you have primary datums, you have datums and tertiary datums. So primary datum will be independent. Secondary datums can be depend upon your predecessor primary datum, and tertiary datum can be depend upon your predecessors. That is your either secondary datum or primary datums. So we will go into that, but the point or takeaway from this slide is that there are two terminologies. One is datum and datum feature. Datum is something which is ideal. It is imaginary and theoretical. So it is something which is smooth, flat, no waviness. Whereas datum feature is the surface or feature of size associated with the part. It is a portion of the part. Okay, so it will have waviness. So it cannot be ideal. So datums are used in manufacturing process as well as for the quality inspection process to hold the part and to make accurate measurements. So what happens if datums are not there? When the datums are not there, what we will do is that we measure the dimensions here and there by using a different points, and obviously each inspection engineer will have different values. There'll be ups and downs. So this will again lead to inaccuracy. Because the part surface is not ideally smooth. So then the CMM accurate positioning of the part to make it the accurate dimensional inspection. So to resolve this issue, we use datum feature because we actually identify the flat surface from which we need to make measurements. As I said, the CMM will take few points on the portion of the surface of the part. It will create an imaginary plane, and from that it will measure all the other dimensions of the part. So it will be reliable. Next important terminology is the feature control frame. So this feature control frame actually consists of a system of boxes. You can find a number of boxes, right? You have a number of compartments and number of boxes. And this actually gives information to the manufacturing team on how to manufacture the part. And this is a language of GD&T. Now, why do I need a feature control frame? I can just instruct him directly, right? So the thing is that, for example, if you take a cylinder block, a cylinder block will have a number of holes. It can be an oil holes, it can be water holes, it can be holes for making measurements, taking the temperature, or to keep a probe, okay, or customer required holes. There can be a number of holes, hundreds of holes will be there in a cylindrical block. Now for each hole, I cannot go to each hole and I cannot say that the hole size should be so and so diameter. The size tolerance of the hole should be 0.5, and I cannot specify the same information, right? So I can just in text, for example, remember if I'm just understand, if I'm going to specify for each hole in the cylinder block that there is a hole here, and I'm going to give a position tolerance for this. Is the first one is a position tolerance. The hole is having a diameter so and so. Its size tolerance 10 mm plus or minus 1 is its size tolerance, and it is having a position tolerance. This is a position tolerance symbol, the first compartment, a position tolerance whose value of the position tolerance is 0.0, which is a circular type position tolerance, and it's having a maximum material condition. You have three datums, datum A, datum primary datum is A, prime secondary datum is B, tertiary datum is C, and only for the secondary and tertiary datum, the maximum material condition applies. So if I'm going to give all this information in text, then I think the print will have only textual information and I cannot have any drawings in the print. So to resolve this issue, ASME has come up with this compressed textual information in the form of feature control frame. So the feature control frame tells exact tolerance that needs to be held on the feature. Okay, so this feature control frame can be applied to a surface or a feature. So what is a feature? A feature can be a hole, a feature can be a pin, a feature can be a tab. Tab is nothing but pin means you have the projection will be cylindrical projection. If the same projection is like a rectangle or a square, so we are calling it to be as a tab. So feature control frame actually applies to both surface as well as to all features and gives informations on all the exact tolerances that we need to give it to the feature. So this is a standard format. You need not give a textual information. So against every hole, I can easily give the symbol and I can just mark the values. So by default, you can understand what does it mean. So we'll just discuss what are the compartments in it. So you have the first box. The first box over here, which actually gives you information on the tolerance type. So what is the geometric tolerance symbol? What is the tolerance type? Well, whether it is flatness, whether it is a, here it is a true position, but it can be a flatness, it can be angularity, it can be perpendicularity and so on. It gives information on the geometric tolerance type. Okay, and the second one gives information on the tolerance zone. That is, since it is a hole, the tolerance zone is a cylindrical tolerance zone. And what is the value of it? So it gives information, comes into picture. Tolerance need, what does the tolerance need to be given? See, for a pin and a hole, will have a circular feature. It's a circular feature. So the tolerance zone by default, it is a diameter. Okay. And for a tab or slot, which is not a circular feature, then you have to remove this size, this modify this particular symbol will not become, diameter won't come for the, when you have a slot or a tab, so which is not a circular feature, then we need to eliminate this particular tolerance zone. We'll have only the value specified. So the first one will be your tolerance type. Second one will be the value of the tolerance. It is sometimes we also affix the zone shape, whether it is a cylindrical zone shape. This zone shape depends upon the feature. If it is a circular feature, we can give this diameter as the zone shape. Otherwise, we will only specify the value. And then we'll have a modifiers. So and then we'll have the datums. The third compartment is nothing but datums. Datums, you'll be giving the datums in the particular order. So we have a precedence in it. So all geometric features are measured from some reference point on the part, and that reference point we are calling it to be as the datum. Sometimes you need more than one reference datum to measure the particular feature. In that particular case, we give more than one datums, and it should be in a particular order. So for example, in the case when more than one datum is there to indicate a particular feature, for example, if a hole should be measured from bottom face as well as from another face from the left side of the slab, then you will be providing two datums, A and B, and you need to specify the order in which you have to provide it, which is primary and which is secondary. So this will actually help the inspection team on how it has to be positioned. First, position the bottom surface. Then you have to fix the left portion of the part, and then you have to measure the hole to get the reading. So these precedence, the order in which you are going to specify the datums, actually helps the inspection team and manufacturing team in making that particular feature or measuring the dimension of that particular feature. For example, you can just see this particular hole. Okay, so this hole you can just see. To measure this hole, they have specified two datums, datum A and datum B. So it actually says the machining team that first you have to fix this particular datum surface, then you have to fix the datum surface B, and then only you can drill the hole to get this feature. In addition, you're also giving information to the inspection team that you hold the part, you have to arrest the degrees of freedom by fixing the surface datum A, and then you'll arrest the degrees of freedom by fixing the surface datum B, and then only you can measure the center of this hole. So these informations you'll be providing in this particular datum. That is the reason we need the order in which you have to specify the datum is important. So this modifiers actually gives information on the bonus tolerances. So we'll be discussing what do you mean by bonus tolerances in the upcoming slides. We'll discuss it. So the takeaway is that the feature control frame is actually gives information on how the feature values and how the feature to be controlled. It is a standard set of box format, and it'll have three compartments mainly. One is the tolerance type, other one is the tolerance value. The last compartment will be your datums. So tolerance type followed by the value for the tolerance, and finally the datums. So this should be your takeaway. And we'll have some questions on this. So in this, you can see this is the position tolerance. Just a second. Okay, so maybe okay, so here instead of quiz, I'll just explain to you. So here the hole, you can just see this hole over here, the hole, I think the diameter of the hole, let's say that's 10 mm diameter of the hole. So there's a true position over here. So here you'll have a tolerance zone. So what is the center of this hole should lie within a small circular whose diameter is 0.02 mm. Okay, so the center of this hole, when you're measuring it, so how they will measure it is that they will just measure the 4 points. The CMM will measure 4 points on the circle of this hole, and then it will calculate its center. And if that center is said to lie within the tolerance zone, then we will be accepting this part. Okay, so that's how the readings will be done. Second thing is that second one we can just see over here. So the main reason why I have given this is that to show you that the datum D is actually dependent upon datum B. Okay, so one datum is dependent upon datum the other datum. So here the parallelism, so this you can just see, this is the parallelism. So the parallelism of the center of the slot is shown 0.03 mm, which means that here you have an ideal flat surface. So what is the surface? This is the ideal flat surface. So for this ideal flat surface, this axis, okay, because listen, this particular GDNT says that the axis of the slot should lie between two parallel planes of 0.03 mm. And it should be, when you're measuring it from the flat, it should be parallel to 0.03, parallel to the surface B. It should be parallel to the surface B. It should be parallel to surface B. Along with being parallel to surface B, it should lie between two parallel planes, which is 0.03 mm apart. So that's the reason I just wanted to add this information to you. So the one more point you have to remember is that, see the feature of size, what is the feature of size over here? The feature of size over here is nothing but an axis. Okay, because we have said that the datums can only be applied to feature and feature of size. So the feature of size over here is not the diameter, it is the axis, which actually means that the axis should lie between two parallel planes. So the feature of size over here is the axis. That's another one point I wanted to explicitly let you know, that the feature of size sometimes can be an axis. It need not be just diameter, width, breadth. So it can also be, sometimes the feature of size can be an axis also. So that is one more point I wanted to stress at this particular example. So the next one is the symbols used in GDNT. So here you can just see there are a number of symbols. As said, the GDNT is consist of a standard set of symbols and notations. So we will be just looking on some basic symbols, so that, because I can't cover all the symbols, that is what we can find in most of the prints, you can find it. So the two symbols which I've already said you, one is the max metal condition, other one is the least metal condition. And the projected tolerance zone is that, for example, if I don't want the tolerance zone, for example, if you have a hole like this, and maybe, yeah. Okay, we'll take this hole. So I don't want the tolerance zone to be to the entire depth of this particular block. I just want the tolerance zone to be applicable only to 2 mm, half of this width of the block. Then I will go for projected tolerance zone. Only to a projected length. A tolerance zone will not be applicable for the entire depth, only for a projected tolerance zone. And free state will be used by gauge inspectors. So we'll be concentrating more on the frequently used modifiers. In most of the prints, you'll find max metal condition and least metal condition modifiers. So we'll discuss that in detail now. We'll spend some more time on the bonus tolerances. So here from this image, it is clear that you have a 6 mm hole. and the size tolerance for the 6 mm hole is plus or minus 0.05. Okay, I have given a feature control frame. In the feature control frame, I have mentioned that the center point of the hole, true position geometric tolerance, which means that the center point of the hole should lie within a cylindrical tolerance zone of 0.015. And I've given a symbol maximum metal condition with respect to A and B datums. So what does that mean? And what does this bonus tolerance means? We will see that. So here, this is the diameter of the hole is 6 plus or minus 0.05. At maximum metal condition, hole is an internal feature. So its minimum diameter is where you have the maximum material. So at maximum metal condition, the position tolerance is 0.015. Okay, the position tolerance is 0.015. Maybe let's take a small paint. So we'll just hide these two stuffs. So you can just see that I have a hole, not a perfect hole, round one. So what does it say is that here the center of this hole should lie at a smaller hole whose diameter is 0.015. So as long as the center of this bigger hole, 6 mm hole, is said to lie within this tolerance zone, I can accept this part. Then where come this bonus tolerance comes? Bonus tolerance comes in the phase that, see, bonus tolerance is said to be used, or the maximum metal condition is generally used when the fit that you are saying is said to be a loose fit. Okay, that is, you have a lot of clearances. We go for the maximum metal condition. And least metal condition is used when I want an interference fit. Okay, so what does this particular first one says is that, so when I have the maximum metal condition, the hole is like 65.95 is nothing but the diameter of the hole at its MMC, at its maximum material condition. Now at maximum metal condition, the hole is actually having more material. So my aim is to get more clearance. I want a loose fit, right? So when will I have a loose fit? Okay, that will be a question to you all. So when will I have a loose fit? When the hole diameter is at maximum diameter, or when the hole diameter is minimum? Or just say me the diameter at which I'll have maximum clearance. Just chat it. Where is the chat box? So just chat it. What will be the diameter of the hole at which I'll have maximum clearance? Yes, you will have the maximum clearance when the hole diameter is at maximum. That is, when the hole diameter is still more bigger. Okay, that is, when the hole diameter is still more bigger, I will have that 6.05, which is nothing but the diameter of the hole at its maximum diameter of the hole, or its least material condition. I will have more clearance because I'll have this much amount of clearance. Correct. So since I have more clearance, I can also slightly relax my position tolerance. So is it clear, right? So since I have, so if the hole sizes keep on increasing, so because at maximum metal condition it should be perfect, but if I keep on increasing the hole size, my clearance increases. So why I need to again tighten, have the same tight position tolerance? I can also relax my position tolerance. I can also relax, because at maximum diameter, I can also relax my position tolerance a little bit. I can give them a bonus tolerance so that even if the center of the hole is outside this 0.015, but if the hole diameter is a little bit larger, I'm saying that it is having more clearance, still the shaft can enter into the hole and the fit is possible, clearance fit is possible. That is what we are going to see here. So As I'm increasing the hole diameter, you can see at the maximum metal condition, when the hole diameter is very small, Okay, the clearance is very small, so I need to have the position tolerance as 0.015. I cannot relax it. But as the hole diameter is keep on increasing, if I'm keep on increasing the hole diameter, my clearance increases. So what I'm saying is that, okay, to the manufacturing team, okay guys, you can, I give you some relaxations, you can still increase your bonus tolerance, even though the center of the hole is not exactly not in the 0.015, even if it is in some 0.025, I'm accepting it if the hole diameter is 5.96. So as the hole diameter increases, my clearance increases, so I'm relaxing the position tolerance from 0.15 with respect to the increase in size. If the hole diameter increases by 0.01, I'm increasing my position tolerance by 0.01. If a hole diameter increases from 0.02, I'm increasing the position tolerance by 0.02. So it keeps with the proportional increase in hole diameter, there will be a proportional increase in clearance. So proportionally, I'm also relaxing the position tolerance. I'm increasing it proportionally. That is what you have to remember. That is what the bonus tolerance is all about. So bonus tolerance is said to be provided when you are having, when at the maximum material condition, the same bonus tolerance, same position tolerance appears, applies. But as your hole diameter increases, clearance increases, so you'll have relaxations. So proportionately, I'm also increasing my position tolerance. And this increase in value from 0.015, I'm giving 0.025. So that's a 0.01 increase, is that right? That is what we are calling it to be as the bonus tolerance. So this beautiful benefit is provided by GDNT. So which means that even though the part is not exactly meeting 0.015, it is still acceptable by the dimensional inspection team if diameter is having a proportionate increase in diameter. If the diameter is proportionately increased, then even though the true position is not 0.015, I can still accept it if the diameter is a little bit higher. So this increased tolerances is applicable in when you're having the GDNT. So the same thing in the reverse order. So consider that I want an interference fit. I want it to be an interference fit. Then I'll go for least material condition. The same thing in a vice versa manner, just opposite to it. So when will the hole will have an interference fit? What is the maximum interference fit the hole will have? Just chat it on your box. When will I have the interference fit? When the hole is at the minimum diameter or when the hole is at the maximum diameter? Correct. So when the hole is at the minimum diameter, you will have more material and you will have interference fit. So at the minimum diameter, so that is what, so as the diameter of the hole decreases, the interference increases. I'll have more and more interference. So what is my what is the objective of my objective now has, I don't want a clearance fit. When I want a clearance fit, I'll go for MMC. But now my objective is to have an interference fit. So as my hole diameter decreases, my interference increases. So I can give some tolerance to the position tolerance zone as the hole diameter decreases. That's what is happening over here. When the hole diameter is at maximum conditions, I cannot give any relaxations. It should strictly, the center of the hole should fall in the tolerance zone of 0.015. But as my hole diameter decreases and my objective is to have an interference fit, then I can relax the position tolerance from 0.015 proportionately with decrease in the hole diameter. So I hope that you have understood the LMC and MMC. MMC is used for the clearance fit. LMC is used for the interference fit, right? And as the hole diameter increases, your clearance increases, I give MMC a bonus tolerance. And in LMC, as the hole diameter increases and my objective is interference fit, I give LMC and I give you the bonus tolerance as the diameter of the hole keeps on decreases proportionately. I'll give you the bonus tolerance increase. That's what you can see it over here. As the diameter increases, your interference increases, and then proportionately, I'll also increase my I'll give relaxation and I'll increase my position tolerance zone. So I think the MMC and LMC is covered. And finally, it's your regardless of feature of say. That is, if I'm not giving any modifier, you can just see. That is the rule number two. If there is no modifier specified in the feature control frame, there is no max material condition modifier, neither a least material condition modifier, then by default it applies regardless of feature of size. What is that? It means even though your whole diameter is at maximum material condition or the minimum material condition, or how your whole diameters keep on varying, I don't bother about anything. You have to strictly the center of the hole should lie within the tolerance zone what I have provided, irrespective of the hole size. Even the holes are, even there's a variation in the hole size, it is increases or decreases, I don't bother. My center of the hole at whatever size, whatever its size, whether its size is at maximum diameter or minimum diameter, it should have its center within this tolerance zone. I won't give any bonus tolerance. That is what regardless of feature of size means. Do you have any questions in this? Just you can type. Students, if you have any questions on bonus tolerance, you can ask me, because there's some concepts which will not be explained in detail in books, is difficult to understand.
Also, you can unmute yourself and ask. Do you have any doubts?
Sir, is there any case bonus tolerance related with the axis of
bonus tolerance related to the
axis of the project?
So actually what is that the true position tolerance that you give, right? So this is actually associated with 2D. That is, we won't give bonus to true position for along the axis. So if you want to control the hole center throughout the axis of the hole, along the entire depth you are going to center it, then you have to give coaxiality. We'll be doing, looking at it later slides. So, but for true position is only for 2D, just on the whole 2D face. That is, we'll be bothering about X and Y. We don't consider the Z. That's what your question, right? Or
Yes, sir.
Okay. If you want to control the whole axis, we'll be have to give coaxiality constraint. We'll be discussing in the upcoming slides. Okay. So I'll move to the next. So here, these are the 14 geometric symbols that we use generally for controlling the shape. So there are some tolerance types. So we can group this into five: form tolerance, orientation, location, runout, and location derived from median points. So one thing I would like to say is that by using these geometry, there are some geometric tolerances that actually controls both location as well as the shape of the feature, where that feature is located, along with how that feature should be. So both shall be controlled by some GD&T groups, but some groups may not do so. So we'll just see what are those in detail. So first we will see the orientation tolerance. So orientation tolerance is one of the group in which what we say is that you can see the first image at the bottom. This is the slanting surface, which is nothing but the feature. So this feature should lie at an angle of 60 degrees from the datum plane A, and the surface, the slanting surface, the slantness should be between two parallel planes, which is 0.03 mm apart. So it is clear that to define this orientation tolerance, you need a datum. You need a reference datum, because this orientation tolerance not only controls the shape, it not only controls the waviness of the flat surface and the slantness angle. In addition to that, it also instructs the manufacturing team or the inspection team that this slanting surface, it is located at a particular angle from datum. So this is being this has both the jobs. It controls the surface as well as it controls the location also. It gives information about the location also. So it controls the shape. And this is how you need to measure it. So you measure it by actually, if it is inclined by 60 degree, you have to rotate it by 60 degree on the other side. And by the way, you can make it a flat plate surface bed like thing. And then you can keep the dial indicator gauge above it. And then you can measure its waviness. And its waviness, the peaks and crest should lie between the two parallel planes, which is 0.03 mm apart. So that is one. Second thing, you'll have the perpendicularity. So we'll be spending less time on these perpendicularity and on the geometric symbols. We'll just understand how it is being used, and we'll see some examples and applications where we actually what happens if it is not used. So perpendicularity, it is clear that the same thing. Here in the orientation is the angle. The same thing. It should be this particular plane. This particular surface should lie between two parallel planes, which is perpendicular to the datum A, and it should be between, and it should be parallel to two planes, which is 0.03 mm apart. This perpendicularity, in some cases, if you just see, means for it will be an axis. It need not be two planes. At some cases, it will be a cylindrical tolerance zone. When perpendicularity is given to feature of size, see, the perpendicularity can be applied to both surface as well as to a feature of size. Feature of size means it can be a pin, it can be a it can be a slot, it can be a tab, anything. So when the feature of size is a hole, okay, or a pin, what happens is that the tolerance zone is no longer two parallel planes. It becomes a cylindrical tolerance zone. So the axis of the shaft should lie between the cylindrical tolerance zone, which is perpendicular to datum A, and the diameter of the cylindrical tolerance zone is 0.2 mm. So as long as this axis lies within the cylindrical tolerance zone of 0.2 mm perpendicular to the datum surface A, this part is acceptable. And then we'll have the parallelism. All has the same concept. So the symbol for parallelism, this is the tolerance zone and this is the datum. As I have said, right, the feature control frame consists of three parts. The first one is the tolerance, geometric tolerance type. Second one is the tolerance value. And third one is the datum associated with the tolerance. So here it is the same thing. So the particular, the top face we can just see is said to be parallel from datum surface A. It should be parallel to it, and it should be between the two parallel planes, which is 0.03 mm apart. As long as this face is parallel to these two planes, between the two planes, the waviness is said to be between these two planes, the part is acceptable. And the next one is the form tolerance. So the form tolerance is nothing but it controls the shape of the feature of size and also the shape of the surface. Okay, but the form tolerance will not control the location of the surface. It is not bothered where the surface is located. It is located from datum A by a distance of 10 mm or 20 mm. That is not, it is not bothered about it. That's the reason why in the forms tolerances, we don't have a reference datum. It's like here we have reference datum, right? But such reference datum, you will not find it in the form tolerance. That is, in cases where I am not bothered about the location, I am only bothered about how the shape is, then I'll go for form tolerance. So form tolerance, you have the flatness, straightness, cylindricity, and circularity. So flatness is nothing but should be, the surface should be flat. The waviness of the surface should be between two parallel planes, correct? Then it is said to be acceptable. Straightness is 2D, flatness is 3D. Similarly, circularity is for 2D and cylindricity is for 3D. That is what you can just see it over here. So this is the straightness. So the straightness you can just see. This is a, if for a particular section, for example, if we have a particular cylindrical shaft, I cut the shaft, I section that particular shaft, and if the circle of that particular cut section is within two concentric circles, which are 0.03 mm apart, I accept it. Or else, no, my condition is that the entire cylindrical shaft enters into a hole, entirely it enters into another hole. So then I need to control the cylindricity throughout the length of the part, then I'll go for cylindricity. If I want to control only at the face level, so I'll go for circularity. So here the entire surface, it will be taken care of. And we'll move to location tolerance. Location tolerance is nothing like the position tolerance we have it. So we have to locate the hole. Where is the center of the hole is said to be located? So in location tolerance, you have to remember that if the tolerance zone which we are considering is cylindrical in nature, we give diameter. We specify the tolerance zone shape. If it is not cylindrical, which you can see over here, it is not cylindrical, then it is optional. You cannot specify it. So those tolerance zone which is cylindrical in nature for pin, like we had a example over here, right? For a pin. So those areas, when the tolerance zone is cylindrical in nature, the feature which we are studying is also a cylindrical feature, then we have to specify, then we'll be specifying the tolerance zone as diameter. If not, there won't be any tolerance zone specified. If the feature is not cylindrical, it is here the feature is a flat surface. It is not cylindrical. So obviously the tolerance zone will be two parallel planes. It won't be a cylindrical zone. So we won't specify any diameter. This one point you have to remember. If the feature is cylindrical, then the tolerance zone is also cylindrical. And then we specify this diameter by default. So here position tolerance actually says that where this center of the hole should lie. Center of the hole should lie in a small tolerance zone of 0.03 circle. So if it lies within this with respect to A and B datums, then the part is said to be acceptable. Okay, so how they will do measure it in CMM is that they will measure the four points of the hole and then they will find the center will be calculated and the center should lie between these two points. If that's so, then we are going to accept the part. Then we'll have the profile of a line. That is, we are bothered only about 2D. Profile of a line is 2D. Profile of a surface is 3D. So when the surface is not cylindrical, it is not same throughout the length. If there is a variation in profile, it can be in something like a B-spline curve, you can just see over here. So at this particular point, I can give it as a profile of a line. When I want it to be extend along its depth, along the 3D direction. So the entire surface, profile surface, I have to, it should be shape, I have to control the shape. Then I will be giving profile of a surface. The entire surface should lie between two similar profile surfaces, which is said to be 0.03 apart. So these two information, these will come under the category of location tolerances. Finally, you have the question, I think Abraham, I don't know his name, I'll just confirm. Yeah, Abraham has asked, what happens if I'm going to control the entire depth? In that case, we have to go for concentricity tolerances. So what does this concentricity tolerance do is that you have two tolerances where the location is derived through median points. So what does this concentricity tolerance do is that it will keep on measuring the point at the top surface of the part, right? And at the bottom surface of the diameter. It will calculate the median. It is the middle of the top and bottom opposing points. That median should lie within a tolerance zone which is extended through the length of the shaft under study of 0.03 mm. So that is what, if you want to control the entire axis, you have to go for concentricity tolerance. Now, what is the most important thing is that this feature is actually helpful in case of crankshafts and flywheels. So we use this concentricity. And the one point that you have to remember is that here we consider the distribution of points. All the points that are said to be distributed in this particular tolerance zone should lie within this tolerance, within the cylindrical tolerance zone. In this blue color cylinder, all the median points lies between this. So here it considers the distribution of the points and all the points should lie in this cylindrical tolerance, blue color tolerance zone, then the part is said to be accepted. Another one point you have to remember is that it does not consider the distribution of density. For example, if this shaft is made by casting and there is a pocket over here, there's a defect over here, there's a pocket over here, there's a pocket defect over here, that's a hollow, there's a casting defect is over here, that is the material is not equally distributed, it doesn't bother, the system doesn't know. CMO machine doesn't. According to the CMO machine, top point and bottom point will take, it will make sure that the median points are distributed in the cylindrical tolerance zone, it is accepted. It is not bothered about the distribution of the density, whether the density is same throughout the shaft and so on. It doesn't take into consideration. So the concentricity does not consider the distribution of material. Okay, it only considers the distribution of the median points. So whether the material at all these points, center is said to be in this particular region, it won't consider. So even if there's a gas pockets, if the density is differing, there's a casting pockets here and there, it won't consider. It only consider distribution of median points. It don't consider the distribution, the density or density distribution. So for example, if upper half of the shaft is having higher density, lower half of the shaft is having lower density, concentricity doesn't matter for concentricity. As long as the two opposing points has a median point, which is said to be lying within this tolerance zone blue color, it accepts it. No matter if density is high or density is low, it does not matter. So for that, you cannot rely on CMO machine. You have to do a radiography testing to understand how the density is said to be distributed. So that is one. And then concentricity is done. And then you have the symmetricity. That is, you can just see it over here. So for non-cylindrical features, we go for symmetricity. So three constant control tolerance. So it is the same thing. You have to measure the top and bottoms. And this is the non-symmetrical feature. The top feature should be symmetric with bottom. So its median point should lie between two parallel planes, which is separated by a distance of 0.03 mm. Here it is a cylindrical feature. So you had a cylindrical tolerance zone. In this case, it is not a cylindrical feature. So you have a tolerance zone is in the form of two parallel planes. So tolerance zone is between two parallel planes because it is not a cylindrical feature. And there's a reason you don't have any shape of the tolerance. Zone shape. You don't have the tolerance zone shape, tolerance zone or shape. You have only the tolerance value specified in the feature control frame. So then you have the coaxial tolerances. So coaxial tolerances have two things. One is the circular runout. The other one is the total runout. Okay. So what do you mean by circular runout and total runout is that? Circular runout is for 2D and total runout is for the 3D. So if you have a shaft like this, if I take the outer periphery of the shaft, I keep the dial gauge over here at this section, at this particular distance from the one end of the shaft, at this section, I rotate the shaft. So if the waviness on the periphery of the shaft is said to be within two concentric circles, which are separated by a so-and-so fixed tolerance zone, 0.03 mm, then the part is accepted. Now, what is the difference between the coaxial and concentricity? Concentricity deals with the axis, distribution of points in the axis, whereas the coaxial tolerance or the circular runout or the total runout, we bother about the periphery. How is the waviness on the periphery of the shaft? So when this waviness, we need to consider for the entire length of the shaft. You have to extend it to the entire length of the shaft. Then we will go for total runout. So this is the total runout. We have to measure it into the entire length of the shaft. The entire length of the shaft should lie between these two points. So I think the coaxiality is completed. And then we will have some questions. We then will move for applications. Okay, so the first question, we'll just open the chat box. I'll keep it in the other window. Well, what is the right statement when push-in tolerance is applied at maximum metal condition? As the hole size increases, your push-in tolerance increases. Hint is it's at maximum metal condition. I want a clearance fit. So what is the option? You can just type it in the chat box. So as the hole size increases, your push-in tolerance increases. As the hole size increases, your push-in tolerance decreases. Hole size is independent of the push-in tolerance. As hole size reduces, your push-in tolerance increases. Now, here you have to think about the MMC at maximum metal condition. Okay. Right, the first option is right. So at the max metal condition, I want a clearance fit. So as the hole size increases, my clearance increases. So I can relax my position tolerance. I will also increase my position tolerance. Second one, what is the coaxiality tolerance applied among the two diameters of the stepped shaft when only limits of size is specified? So I'm only specifying the limits of size. Okay. So if I'm going to give a coaxiality tolerance, what should be the tolerance value? You have to take a tolerance value based on the size limits. It can be 0.004, it can be 0, it can be 0.01. So you have to take the coaxiality size tolerance limit from the size tolerance of its diameters. To be more clear, we'll have this coaxiality tolerance. So I need this value. Okay. So I need this value, coaxiality value. So, but I want this value to be taken from the size limits. So what value you would suggest? Because in some cases, we need to, without coaxiality tolerance, you cannot push the print to manufacturing side, but the part would be already in production. So we are just asking another supplier to produce the part. The print can be a very old print. It might not have a coaxiality tolerance, but you are going for a new supplier. So you are going to revise your print. You are going to give it to a new supplier. In that particular case, it is mandatory to specify GDNT. Without GDNT, your print will not be passed by the design and checking team. So you have to specify some coaxial tolerance. So your only choice is that you have to play with the available size tolerance limits, because you cannot reduce it, because the part is already in production. You're just going for another supplier. That's it. So you have to pick from any of these values. So any examples? And you need to know why you need to pick it. So we'll see why. So I've got some answers like 0.02, 0.004. So I think only one has answered. You can guess. So the options can is 0.004, or it can be 0, it can be 0.01 or 0.02. Okay, so the answer would be the by default. See, you can just see here there is no coaxiality is to be given. So by default, the size tolerance should be specified, right? That actually controls the shape of the two camshafts, the actual coaxiality of the two camshafts. So here, which is the minimum value? Guess the minimum value. What is the minimum value? 0.004 is minimum value, or 0.02 is minimum value?
0.004.
Yes. So by default, your coaxiality is now controlled. This particular old print, it is controlled by your size tolerance, 0.004. So your form tolerance can only be equal to or less than the minimum value of the size tolerance. Okay. If it is equal to, no issues. The same print, or the same production people can do it. If it is less than, the supplier would ask for more cost, because they have to change the manufacturing processes to improve the form value. So it can be, the answer is 0.004. So the form tolerance value must be smaller than or equal to the minimum size tolerance value. Next question. If datum access is required, is datum access is required when runout is specified? So we'll just see. Runout comes under, it's difficult to remember. So do you require a datum access for runouts is the question. The answer is already in the image. So you can specify true or false. You can just answer. you can answer in the chat box. Actually, you require the datum axis. You have the cylindrical axis, you can just see, because to rotate the part in check and the dial gauge is translated across the length of the cylinder. So for that, for the inspection team, you might require the cylinder axis. So datum A is over here, would be the cylinder axis. The image is here. So it is cylinder axis with respect to the runout. So only for form tolerance, it is the flatness, parallelism. Only for the form tolerance, we don't specify datum, reference datums, because form tolerance only controls the shape. It does not control the location. For the other, you need to specify the datum, because that is based on which only you can hold the part for performing the inspection. Because to measure the circle runout itself, you have to fix it in chuck, right? So the axis is your datum, yeah? That's how it measures the dialing gauge. Dialing gauge will be fitted on the top of it, you measure it. So the answer is true. Second one, for the fourth one, if the small diameter shaft needs to be manufactured at, this is the small diameter shaft. If the small diameter shaft is said to be manufactured at 5.004, what is the allowable maximum form variation? I just specify it. This is the small shaft. The small shaft, I need to manufacture the small shaft at a value 5.004. See where the value comes, whether the value is set at upper limit or lower limit. If I want to manufacture this particular shaft at this particular value of upper limit, what should be the variations I can have? Maximum allowable form variations. Can I have a form variation or not? If I can have, what is the maximum form variation? Okay, I'll wait for another 5 seconds. So the hint is, the small shaft is at maximum diameter, maximum material condition. Then can it have any variation in its length? What is the rule one says? Okay, what is the rule one says? When the part is at maximum metal condition, it should be perfect, or you can allow some variations. You can type, as per rule one, if the feature is at maximum metal condition, the part should be perfect, yes or no? You can specify yes or no. Yes, so at the maximum material condition, the part should be perfect. So here, my question is, I need to manufacture the part at maximum material condition at 5.004. Then the part should be a perfect envelope. It should be a perfect cylinder with not even a single form deviation. So the maximum allowable form variation for this small cylinder at maximum material condition is zero. It should be a perfect cylinder. That's what rule one says. Because if I give some variations, it cannot be fit into the mating part, right? Because it is already in the maximum metal condition. And last question, will circular runout control taper when applied to cylindrical feature? Hint is, circular runout is 2D. Even you can also put the total runout also. No issues in that. I can say yes or no. Will circular runout control taper when applied to cylindrical feature? So if there is a taper in this, will it control the shape of the taper in case of circular runout? Yes or no? Right, it does not consider the, it will not control the taper, because it's a 2D tolerance. You take it at different sections, only just says that if it is lying between two concentric circles, it is acceptable no matter how small the diameter. So it should lie between two concentric circles, it is acceptable. So with respect to the axis, so even if it is one end, it has bigger diameter, the other end has a smaller diameter. If that diameter waviness is between two concentric circles of so and so tolerance zone you have specified, it is acceptable. Then we'll see some simple applications. I don't want to add too much a complex example, so I've taken a small example. This is the simple print you can find in an industry. Very simple print. So the most economic and simple print you can find in an industry. This is nothing but a washer print. So washer has only two diameters and then a thickness. So this, the one at the left, shows without GD&T. The middle one is what is the issue that you might happen. And the right last one is the solution. So let us consider this washer. So the washer has an internal diameter of 12 plus or minus 0.2, out diameter of 8.4 plus or minus 0.3, and its thickness is 1 mm plus or minus 0.06. Now, since I haven't controlled the shape of this particular face, both the faces, okay? What happens is that you can just take the right face, it can go from 1.06 to 0.94. So I can have a surface which is slanting or with waviness, where the crest and the trough of the waviness can have a distance of about 0.12 mm. So sorry, 0.06 mm. Is this acceptable? So the top can be 1.06, the bottom one can be 0.94. So I can have a top and this bottom at 0.012 mm. So what happens over here is that when I have a slanting, as per the design you are giving, it is correct. There is no issue. The part is within the spec, so there is no problem in that. So what happens is that when you have a washer in this particular shape, and the washer is said to be used in a high pressure line, high pressure fluid line, and I have tightened the washer, the pressure distribution won't be same. The pressure distribution at this location will not be similar to the pressure distribution at this location. There will be difference in the pressure. The pre-tightening load that they give will vary. As a result of which, what happens is that this will lead to fuel leak. So a very good example is the banjo bolts. So you can just see a bolt over here. So this is where the fuel comes in. It comes to this, this is the banjo fitting. So the fuel comes in high pressure, let it be a fuel from for your engine. It comes in from the fuel injection pump. So this, at this particular section, you have a small hole. This hole enters into it, enters into the bolt hole, lateral hole, and then it comes out of this particular place. So this is the fuel out. So this goes into your fuel injector in the cylinder head. So here I'm using two washers, right? So this washer only actually controls the seepage of the fuel, prevents the fuel to come out. Suppose at this washer, if I'm having the washer in this particular shape, what happens? Fuel will leak. Now, a small example is a small easy reference. I just say some values. The fuel from a high pressure injection pump can go up to 8,000 pascals, correct? Just 300 pounds PSI, sorry, 8,000 PSI, and just 300 PSI, pounds per square inch, is enough to pierce through your body, to get into your body, impinge your body and get through out of your body. So the leak from here will lead to operator injury, but the first thing what happens is that because of this improper washer design, the fuel will leak. When the fuel leaks, what happens is that there will be improper firing. Okay, so that the first thing, you won't get the required amount of power. There will be improper firing. So if there is an improper firing, what happens is that at the time when the valves are open, if the fire combustion has occurred, this will lead to breaking of the valve. Or in other words, we don't go that deep into it. So there'll be a fuel leak, and if the fuel leak is said to be on the cylinder head, remember that the exhaust gas temperature will be around 700 degrees Celsius temperature, and your a manifold through which the exhaust gas passes out, the manifold can reach around 400 degrees Celsius. So if the fuel leak goes onto the surface of the manifold, exhaust manifold, it will catch fire. So the first thing you will notice is there won't be any power. Second thing you will notice is the engine will be on fire. So the root cause is just a small washer, which has not been given a small GDNT. We haven't controlled the phase form of the washer, will ultimately lead to firing of an engine. So it's a very small washer. It is 1-2 rupees or 3 rupees. But still, if the GDNT is not controlled, your function effects as well as, okay. I think you have 5 minutes for that class. Okay, your function effects as well as it will lead to firing of an engine. So this is what you have to control by using the flatness. You have to give the flatness. You must make sure that both the surfaces are parallel in nature. So even if you use the washers on either sides, there won't be any issue. And similarly, you can just see this is a flywheel. Now recent flywheels will have timing holes over here. The function of these timing holes is that it will instruct the ECU, which is nothing but the electronic control unit, ECU will be there. So this will instruct the ECU. So what this ECU will do is that the ECU will get the information from the timing hole, because from the timing hole will say which point your cylinder piston will be at the top dead center. So remember that your piston cylinder will be at top dead center at two options. One is the piston will be at the top dead center at the starting of combustion, and the other one, it will be at the top dead center at the end of exhaust stroke. So the ECU needs to instruct the FIP, fuel injector pump, as well as the unit injector present on the cylinder head, when to inject the fuel. So it gets the information from the timing hole, and it gets another information from the crank camshaft gear. The camshaft gear also will have a similar mag pickup sensor, because your camshaft, for every two rotations of your crank, your cam will make only one rotation. So by having these two information from the cam gear as well as information from the flywheel, the ECU will know that the piston is exactly at the top dead center and it is a time for combustion, and then it will instruct the injector pump to inject the fuel. So you will have unit injectors. Recently we'll have unit injectors. So solenoid actuated unit injectors will be used, and they will inject it. So the timing of these, so the locations of these holes are important. So that's the reason we give the position tolerance. We control them. We control them by using the datums. The axis, the one datum A can be the axis of the shaft, or the axis of the flywheel. Datum B can be the mounting face, the face at which the flywheel gets mounted to the crank palm. So the thing point you have to remember is that these timing holes are critical for fuel injections, because if any change in the fuel injections, then improper combustion will occur. For understand that when the valves are open, if the combustion happens, what will happen is that the stem of the valve will break and will fall inside the, it happened, the stem of the valve has broken and has fallen inside the combustion cylinder chamber. And the engine, but since other cylinders were active, the engine was keep on running. There was some vibration noise. So the operator switched off the engine, and then they removed it, and they found that the stem got broken and fall inside the cylinder. But it was not because of timing issue, but it was because of some other reason. But the same thing can happen because of improper firing. So firing at wrong place. So when the valves are open. So this can also lead to complete damage of engine. You have to completely replace the engine. We cannot replace a single cylinder block, because if the valve falls into the engine, it will damage the cylinder head, piston head, and the entire thing will be, you have to completely replace the entire engine in the warranty claim. So, and with this I will end. So this we can just see the, this is what the designer wants. If you're not going to specify any GDNT, this is what the manufacturer would give you. You can just see. So you can't even mount it in the mating part. So it is not coaxial in nature. So the exact GDNT should be of this particular format. So you have to specify the perpendicularity, position tolerances for the holes, and you have to specify the coactionality over here. So with this, you can, it'll be easy for you to get the part as per your requirement. So this is the place where I have taken it. So if you have any questions, you can ask me. I think.
Yes, students, you can ask the questions if you have any doubts.
Sir, GD&T is mentioned to, like, if I am designing a part and I am sending the design to a manufacturer, so for GD&T, we have to mention it in the drawing of the part, or like if I am sending the 3D modeling part, so will the GD&T be mentioned in that part? Like, when, if I am
okay, if my perception is right, for example, you have designed the, you have done the 3D modeling, correct? So then once after you have done the 3D modeling, you have to take into consideration of your NHLs, next higher level to which that particular part will fit to. Okay, so based on that, as a design engineer, you have to specify the datums. This is my part, this my part will fit to this another part. So you should have a clearance. So if it is having a hole and a shaft should enter into it, means the hole should be axial, how much clearance I can give. So all those things you have to specify. So 3D model will not have any informations. When you draft it, you have to specify all those informations. Based on the next higher level, you have to do a tolerance stack up analysis. Okay, because if you want an interference fit, or I want, based on that, you have to specify the GD&Ts. So like every company has their own checkpoints. So without those GD&Ts, they won't allow you to move to pass the print to the manufacturer. So if there is a hole, they demand for push and tolerance. If it is very significant hole, you give tighter push and tolerance. If it is not so, you give the same tolerance given in the size of the hole. So you calculate the push and tolerance from the size of the hole, and then you can give it. So if it is not that important, so without push and tolerance for holes, without coaxiality or concentricity for bores, it is not possible for you to push it to manufacturing site. The checking team won't even allow you to do so.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yeah, they demand you on value.